This is a long 10-page poem. Holy relics, some of you know it. I'm just going to read the first part. This is Gloria en Saldúa, February 13, 1979. Part 5 of a poem about Santa Teresa, dedicated to Judy Grun and V. Sackville West. And then it has this wonderful epigraph that I love, and I dedicate it to all Libro Traficantes. We are the holy relics, the scattered bones of a saint, the best loved bones of Spain. We seek each other. Isn't that wonderful? Since I had to explain myself, especially if I disappear or something, I just want to read a part of this one. This is from her first poem that she sent here to Mango. And at the time, she was living in San Francisco on Noe, 848 Noe Street. A small growing fire. Written upon Sarah Weddington's approval of President Carter's firing of Bella Azbug, as if replacing Midge Constanza wasn't enough. In Spain, when the Inquisition raged rampant through the world, there lived a Barcelonian woman of the church, a nun, and no other than one of the highest esteem, a mother superior. Like the terrain in which she was born and had never ventured from, she was stark, full of mountainous peaks. Like the wind that rushes across the bay, banked by jagged stone, she chilled whatever warmth crossed her path. She was wont to follow the monastery laws set by Saint Benedict and the rule of the black-frocked priests. But without their diversity, and beyond the limits they had set. Like our Christian father, she considered women the repositories, the instigators of evil, the wickedness of women to be greater than all the wickedness of the world. And later on, this is an 8-page poem. Later on, later, after having said tears, sexed, and none, the early evening chill entered her white wimple, paling her face, crept under her white undergarments, black gown and veil, invaded the white marrow in her bones. A vision appeared to her, a beautiful mosque in Córdoba. The girl emerged, running, tossing her hair and her glances at the tall Moorish youth running to catch her. The girl yielding red mouth to black one, he bending as if to drink from a holy chalice, the palm trees nodding their fronds. And I'll skip. At midnight, she woke from a dream. It had been night. The girl wore the San Benito, the penitent's tunic of sackcloth. She walked toward the quemadero, carrying a lighted candle in her hand, oblivious to the jeers and rocks thudding on her back and the mob close behind her. A Dominican friar stood over her. He promised amnesty if she would but confess her heretic relapses. Confess, confess, he shouted, confess. She said not a word. She said not a word when he lit the torch to her unshod feet. Included with this poem and these poems were a letter from her saying, I don't know if this is Chicana literature. I don't know if this is Chicana literature, but anyway, we know now that it is. And I was going to read Poem for the Young White Man Who Asked Me How I, an intelligent, well-read person, could believe in the war between races, from my first book, but you can find it in many, many anthologies, including the ones, and of course I'm unnamed, including the ones that's on that long list of every single Latino or Mexican American literature textbook on that banned in Arizona list. So look for more banned literature from the Mongo archives. Thank you. friend from Palos Verdes in, underestimated me. You know how rich white kids are. They think I'm dumb. That's my tagline lately. I'm smarter than I look. Poem for the young white man who asked me how I, an intelligent, well-read person, could believe in the war between races. I wrote this when I was 20 years old, and it's in over 200 anthologies, including the Norton anthologies. And they don't want to say that in the banned book list. They don't want to have my name on there, but I'm on all of those, in all of those books. Poem for the young white man who asked me how I, an intelligent, well-read person, could believe in the war between races. And I dedicate this to the dreamers. In my land, there are no distinctions. The barbed wire politics of oppression have been torn down long ago. And the only reminder of past battles lost or won is a slight rutting in the fertile fields. In my land, people write poems about love, full of nothing but contented, childlike syllables. Everyone reads Russian short stories and weeps. There are no borders. There is no hunger, no complicated famine or greed. I am not a revolutionary. I don't even like political poems. Do you think I could believe in a war between races? I could deny it. I could forget about it. Whenever I'm safe living on my own continent of harmony and home. But I am not there. I believe in revolution because everywhere the crosses are burning. Sharp shooting goose steppers round every corner. And there are snipers in the schools. And I know you don't believe this. You think this is nothing but faddish exaggeration. But they are not shooting at you. I'm marked by the color of my skin. The bullets are discreet and designed to kill slowly. And they are aiming at my children. And these are facts. Let me show you my wounds, my stumbling mind, my, excuse me, tongue, and this nagging preoccupation with the feeling of not being good enough. These bullets bury deeper than logic. Racism is not intellectual. I cannot reason these scars away. Outside my door, there is a real enemy who hates me. And I am a poet who yearns to dance on rooftops, to whisper delicate lines about love and the blessings of human understanding. And I try. I go to my land, my tower of words, and bolt the door. But the typewriter doesn't fade out. The sounds of the blasting, the screams, the muffled outrage. My own days bring me slaps on the face. Every day I am deluged with reminders that this is not my land. And this is my land. I do not believe in a war between races. But in this country, there is a war.
Wow.
Thank you.